Good evening and welcome to our USM Corporate Partners event, Beyond the Fear, the Truth About Sports-Related Concussions. My name is Ainsley Wallace, and I'm the Vice President of Corporate Engagement here at the University of Southern Maine.
And I'm Linda Verrill. I'm the President of Broadreach Public Relations, and I'm also a very proud USM alum, as well as adjunct faculty this year on the staff.
And the two of us standing here together is really represents what Corporate Partners is all about: partnership and engagement between a great university and our great community. A Brookings report was recently released demonstrating what they called the outsized impact of urban universities on cities and the important role that great universities play on innovation, research, and jobs. Basically, every great city is a great university and has ways that foster those type of partnerships that cross the town-gown divide. And membership in USM Corporate Partners is one of those type of gateways. Our Corporate Partners members lead the way in hiring, hosting USM interns. You hire our graduates. We work with you to build your brand and awareness on campus. We've recently piloted healthcare job shadows to rave reviews and are looking to do more tailored partnerships with all of you. This is a true partnership and win-win. Together, we create opportunities so that our students graduate ready to enter the workforce in Maine. About 80% of our grads stay within 100 miles of campus, and the other 20% are national rock stars, like our guest tonight, Dr. Micky Collins. So we hope that you enjoy tonight's special event, and throughout the year, we try and have engaging conversations about issues that are facing our community and our world. Our next Corporate Partners event is on January 25th, and it's kicking off a theme of innovation, creativity, and entrepreneurship throughout the spring semester. And that event will focus on what is the university of the future? What will universities look like in 25 years? And we will send you dates about that event, and we hope you're able to join us.
Well, thank you, Ainsley. So this is the best part of the whole program. So this is when we get to introduce our mission moment. But as a business owner, I'd like to reiterate that if you want to get more involved with Corporate Partners, with USM students, faculty, and alumni, it's really important to just say yes and get on board with us. We are looking to have about 100 Corporate Partners by the end of the year, or by next
January.
So we're getting closer. You saw the list in the event we just had, and there's a list out in the lobby. So next, it is my honor to introduce our Mission Moment student, Dan Delgallo. Dan is a recent graduate of USM with a degree in philosophy and sociology. Dan won the first wrestling championship in US history and is a two-time winner of the Elite 90 Award given by the NCAA. Now, I understand that means he was the national champion in his weight class. It honors the best student athletes in the country, and we couldn't be more proud. Dan was featured in the recent USM Connects magazine, which you can pick up on your way out. And if you haven't already seen it, it also has our president, Glenn Cummings, right on the cover. So Dan, I want to thank you for joining us tonight, and we can't wait to hear what your future holds.
Hello. Before I came to USM, I was not a national champion. I was not a two-time Elite 90 winner. And just for those who don't know, the Elite 90 Award is given out to the person at the NCAA tournament. So there's like 180 qualifiers throughout the country. And the person with the highest GPA at that tournament gets the award. So I was not that. I had not won any of the awards that I got, and I had not achieved any of the goals that I wanted to accomplish. I was just a kid from Central Maine. I was, and I've always been, for as long as I can remember, a wrestler. I've not always been a good student. My senior year in high school, I wasn't even sure I wanted to attend college. I wasn't sure what I wanted to do with my life. But one thing I was sure of is I wanted to be the best wrestler that I could be. I wanted to be a national champion. I came to USM because of wrestling. I was recruited by the coaches to wrestle. but they emphasized that I should make the right decision based on the right decisions, or based on the right reasons. Going to college is too big of a decision to just be based on wrestling. They told me to make sure that it was the right decision for me, to pick a place that was right beyond wrestling. When I visited USM, I had these things in mind. During my recruit trip, I focused on, figuring out the school, looking at different things, just not the wrestling room. I decided to go to USM, and my main focus was to be a wrestler, but I found out right off the bat that there's more to college than wrestling. I had a lot of classes that were very hard, and it took up even more time than wrestling did, and which was a big thing for me because I never experienced that. Yeah, in high school I had decent grades, but nothing too impressive. And I've been asked a bunch of times what changed between high school and college academically. And my answer has always been that I took that effort and the standard I held myself to in wrestling and I applied it to schoolwork as well. In wrestling, being coached well will make you a good wrestler. And the same is true for school. I would never become the student that I am today without the great professors that I had. They pushed me to work hard and molded me into a good student. They made the topics that we were teaching genuinely interesting, and they were willing to help me when I struggled. They pushed me to grow and held me to a high standard. All it took was a little willingness to work for me. As my time at USM progressed, it became more and more evident that this was the place for me. I was able to grow and flourish here. And on the surface, USM looks like many other colleges. I could have studied philosophy and sociology at a different school. I could have wrestled for another school. But I don't think things would have played out quite the same way. The difference between USM and those other places, for me, is the people that are here. Many other universities offer similar things, but facilities and services by themselves don't guarantee success. I was made into the person I am now, a summa cum laude graduate with a double major, two-time Elite 90 award winner, all-time winner, win leader in USM wrestling history, and the program's first national champion by USM. These things didn't happen on my own. It took a whole bunch of people, and these people are found at USM. I came here with the goal to be a national champ. I achieved that goal, and USM helped. But the cool thing about my experience at USM is that it helped me discover and develop and achieve goals that I had not even thought about or considered. I'm very grateful and thankful for the time that I've spent here.
Thank you, Dan. Dan has brought an enormous amount of pride to our school. And I just want to please join me in thanking one more time for being up here tonight. When Micky found out that he had been a national wrestling champion, he said, "You better say something really nice about him." I just have the honor tonight to be able to introduce one of our very, very successful alumni. And he is a man who is very humble about the things he's done, so this introduction will probably be embarrassing and painful for him. But I want to tell you, first of all, when he was here, Coach Ed Flaherty of the baseball team said he was the best baseball player he ever had. Okay, he didn't really say that, but I put that in his mouth. But he played an excellent game of baseball. He came down from the Herman area, and he graduated from USM summa cum laude, went on to get his PhD from Michigan State, and found a niche around really looking at the impact just as this issue of concussion started to hit really national headlines. And so what you're going to hear tonight is some of the work that he's done. He was able to put together medical scanning equipment to help us do better diagnoses. He's been able to form relationships with some of the most talented professional athletes in the world and helping them get through very, very difficult times. And most notably, he was smart enough to marry a fellow USM Husky. He's got four beautiful children, a place in Cape Elizabeth, but lives out in Pittsburgh, and he's very proud to tell me that he's not rooting for the Patriots this weekend, and that's the only thing I could find in his bio that seemed a little weak, but I'll just finish by saying that tonight he's going to talk, obviously, for those of you who are deeply into the issue in the physiology of concussions, this will be a touch of that, but really it's designed to be a community-engaged discussion. He'll talk for about 35, 40 minutes, and then really cede the rest of the time for you to ask questions and make it informal. Let me just say, how many of you have either had a concussion or have somebody in your family or close circle of friends that have had a concussion? This is something when I was a kid, we never even talked about, right? And I was just a kid of just a few years ago. So, okay. But what's happened today is people are increasingly aware of the implications short-term and long-term of this incredible impact that it has on the human brain and why that matters and why taking care of it and being able to know things about it really make a difference, really matter, especially in areas of sports, but in any kind of context. So with that, I'm going to turn it over and ask you to please join me in welcoming Dr. Micky Collins.
Thank you, Dr. Cummings, and it's a real humbling invite to be here, and it means a lot. You know, it's the first time I've stepped foot on this campus, on Portland campus, for a while. I've been back to see Coach Flaherty, I've seen Al Bean and Gorham, but coming back here is pretty special, and it's just, I don't know, you know, you reflect back on how you got to this point in your life, and I came from Central Maine, just like you, and came here, my mom and dad, my mom's in the audience, she surprised me, and I did not invite her, she just kind of showed up. But my mom and dad taught me at Hiram High School. My dad coached me in three sports. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I knew I wanted to play baseball for Coach Flaherty, and I came to USM with an intellectual curiosity, but quite frankly, I was probably I wasn't that great of a baseball player, as Coach will tell you, but I thought I was, and I came here more as a baseball player than a student. And then I met a few professors along the way at USM that really pressed my buttons at a time when they needed to be pressed. And I'll never forget Coach Flaherty comes up to me and says, Micky, if you don't declare a major today, you're ineligible. And I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I had this really cool psychology and biology course with a guy named John Broida. And I'm like, well, that's kind of neat. I'm going to do that. And, you know, and little did I know, you know, whatever, 25 years later, I'd be standing here talking to you about this injury that I've grown very passionate about. But I know that USM gave me the tools, not only intellectually and academically, but socially, I think, maybe more importantly. When athletes see me, it's, you know, I got the white coat thing going on, so that kind of covers that. But They want to know that I care. They want to know that I understand their situation. They want to know why they're feeling the things they're feeling, and they want to get better. And I don't know, there's a very large social component to that, and I think USM taught me a lot about that. And I'm just so thankful for the university and the education that I've had here. So with that being said, I wanted to share with you my life's work tonight and talk about this issue of concussion. And I think there's a lot of misinformation out there about this injury. I actually feel it's a treatable condition, and I actually feel it's not the boogeyman, and I feel it's something we can figure out, and we have made advances in treatments, and we can get kids back into the sports they love and do it in an efficacious and safe way. That's the angle I'm coming from tonight. And there's a lot of information out there about this injury, but what I wanted to focus on tonight was really the advances we're making in understanding and treating concussion. I do want to disclose before starting, if I can figure this out, that I'm a developer and shareholder of Impact Applications. It's a computerized tool used to measure concussion. I'm going to speak very briefly about Impact tonight, But this is a tool. Understanding the injury and the gestalt of the injury, it's so much more than that tool, but it's important that I do disclose that interest. So the objectives of this evening, I'm going to start with a case study, just because I think it sets the stage. I want to talk briefly. I had an hour and 15-minute lecture planned, but I thought the dialogue would be important. So I've kind of cut it down a little bit. I'm going to talk about 30 to 40 minutes or so, and I'm going to provide a brief overview of what we know about concussion and topics of concern, and there are many. But then getting into the treatment part of it, I want to talk about that we've actually learned there's different types of concussions, and we've learned there's 6 different types. And guess what? If you match the right treatment to the right problem and you figure out where the aberrant signal's coming from, we can get kids better from this injury in a quicker way and get them back to the sports they love. And that, you know, if there's 30 different types of knee injuries, why do we think there's one type of concussion? The brain is infinitely more complex. And looking at it in a heterogeneic way rather than a homogeneous way, which is what we've been doing, is a way more effective approach at understanding and actually matching the right treatment to the right right problem. And then, of course, I want to open up for dialogue. So let's go through a case study to kind of highlight this issue. So this is a professional football player. Yes, he plays for the Pittsburgh Steelers, and I do work with the Steelers. And yes, I am a Steelers fan. I was a huge Patriots fan growing up. I don't know when it happened, but it did happen, and I apologize for that. When you work with them every day, and I'm there every day, it kind of gets in your blood, okay? But I'm a huge Sox fan. That's not changing at all right? This is their wide receiver for the Steelers. You're going to see in the video here that he had an unsuspecting contact at the left temporal area of his helmet. Now, that actually plays a role. Neck strength plays a huge role with this injury. The people that have strong necks and are prepared to be hit, the forces actually translate from the head to the body. So if the patient knows they're going to be hit and they're doing the hitting themselves, that neck does a really good job of translating force. That's why woodpeckers don't get concussions. I was taught that by Remo Recipudi at USM. They have a bone that connects the base of its shoulder blades to its skull. It's called an occipital condyle, and it's there for a reason. That translates force. But the people who get concussed are the ones that don't see the hit coming and don't expect it. The neck is loose, the forces stay on the head, the brain moves in the skull, and all kinds of bad stuff happens. I'll explain all that. But that's what happened in this case. He had a rotational biomechanical force. You're going to see that he falls to the turf and has a loss of consciousness. Unlike a lot of individuals that go through this injury, this individual had no risk factors. We actually find that car sickness is maybe the biggest risk factor for bad outcome from concussion. Yeah, migraine's a big risk factor for bad outcome from concussion. History of anxiety is a risk factor. Being female is a risk factor. He had none of those things going on. And this is actually his first concussion that he experienced. But you're going to see the video here. And let me give you some context. This is a very important part of the game. It's the last minute of the game. The Steelers are driving. They're down by a touchdown or maybe 6 points at the time. It's a playoff game. And whoever wins this obviously goes on to the AFC, you know, advances in the AFC field. And the Steelers are down. They're driving. You can see they're on the 50-yard line. And this is what happens. And so you're going to see he loses consciousness. You see his arm go up. That's called posturing. It's a brainstem phenomena where you get some motor consequences of the brain injury. And, you know, quite honestly, you're not going to believe this, but losing consciousness actually might be protective for concussion. On-field dizziness is 6.5 times more likely predicting poor outcome from concussion than is losing consciousness. Perhaps the reason why is because patients that lose consciousness are taken out of play. Okay, patients that are dizzy have to report that dizziness. It's a symptom, not a sign. And patients that are dizzy may play through it. And when you play through this stuff, the outcomes aren't very good. You need to be taken out of play. And in this situation, you know, all eyes are on it. The guy's taken out of play. And, you know, let's talk about what happens in the brain when we have a concussion. The word concussus literally translates from Latin to English to mean to shake violently. And think about our brain as an egg yolk inside an eggshell. Well, inside our brain, we have billions of cells called neurons, right? Each neuron is connected by an axon, and that's what controls our behavior as human beings. What actually causes concussion is this, is when the brain moves inside the skull, the membrane to the neuron will get stretched, and this little chemical called potassium, which is supposed to be inside the cell, will get leaked outside of the cell. And when that happens, the brain, there's an increased demand for glucose or energy. That happens. So the cell is saying, I need more energy, something's wrong. At the same time, across that same stretch membrane, calcium, which is supposed to be outside the cell, will get leaked into the permeability, it gets stretched. Calcium will leak in, and when calcium goes into the cell, our blood vessels constrict. It's called vasoconstriction. We get less cerebral blood flow. And at the very time the brain's demanding more energy, this influx of calcium results in less blood flow, which means we get less supply of energy. And all concussion is this sort of energy crisis that affects the neuron. And these cells don't communicate as efficiently as they normally would. The brain's sluggish. The cells are sluggish. Now, what we've learned, and I'm going to talk about this later, kind of a spoiler alert, but when this energy problem happens, different systems can become decompensated in the brain. And we've actually found that six different kinds of problems can occur. It actually is not how hard you get hit in the head, it's what you bring to the table when you get hit in the head as to how bad your outcome is. For example, patients with a history of car sickness have more vulnerability to a system in the brain called the vestibular system. And that system will decompensate more easily in that person than the next person. And so it's not necessarily G-forces that cause concussion, it's actually risk factors that cause this injury to manifest in a more significant way. But think about it this way. Some parts of the brain aren't working as efficiently as they should be. And as clinicians, if you can find out where the aberrant signal's coming from with this, you can actually match the right treatment to treat the problem. And I'll talk extensively about that. So with the football player you just saw, you saw that he had a loss of consciousness for several seconds. He doesn't remember the initial he remembers getting hit, but then he doesn't remember anything for about 5 minutes. He's on the sideline. Team neurosurgeon Joe Maroon, one of my close colleagues, saw him on the field, took him out of play. He didn't go back to play. He did report some very mild symptoms. Believe it or not, he kind of gets out of this loss of consciousness. He's got a mild bifrontal headache. He had some blackened vision bilaterally. And he also had this slow, wavy dizziness feel. Like, kind of feels like he was on a boat, kind of feels one step behind, detached, disassociated, removed. We call that fogginess. And what those symptoms are different systems that are decompensating. If you actually know what symptoms these patients have immediately, it starts to give you an idea of what system decompensates. And that slow, wavy dizziness feeling is the vestibular system decompensating. The vision change is the ocular system decompensating. And then later on, he ended up getting a more severe headache with light noise sensitivity, which is a migraine, which is another type of concussion. But he had the next day, he had a headache that was about 2 out of 10, some light and noise sensitivity, which again is kind of a migraineous type problem, had some nausea, foggy, fatigue, and then he went to a team meeting and he had trouble taking notes and having a hard time focusing on the information, and he's watching film and he really started to get a headache. Now, keep in mind that, first of all, this is probably the toughest human being you'll ever meet. He is not someone that wants to come out of play. In fact, the Steelers ended up winning the game on that play. There was two flags thrown, one from the late hit and then another something happened. 30-yard penalty, the Steelers end up scoring and winning the game. And so, of course, a week later, they have a playoff game. This is the number one receiver in the NFL. He's coming to see me 2 days after this event. It's my job to determine if he can go back to play. That's what I do. And so I embrace that role. But there's a lot of pressure on the athlete, there's a lot of pressure on me. I can tell you very explicitly, I don't get called from the head coach, I don't get called from anybody. It's my job to determine if this guy can go back to play or not. So I'll get back to his case later on. Let's talk about the topics of concern with concussion, and there are many. And quite honestly, I've been doing this for, 17, 18, 19 years. It's all I've done. I'm a one-trick pony. You have me do anything else, I will probably fail miserably. But for some reason, I can do the concussion stuff, okay? And I've been doing this every day, all day, for a long time. And the reason I get so passionate about this area is because when my feet hit the floor in the morning, I'm like, I want to learn more, I want to learn more, I want to learn more. And every day, I learn more. And we learn more by failing. We learn more by patients not getting better. And we got to figure out our errors and mistakes and get better at what we do. And we've happened to learn a lot about this injury. But the truth is there's a lot of science that needs to happen here with this injury. There's a lot of questions we don't have answers to scientifically. I can tell you anecdotally, and we've published 250 papers on this injury, but there's still a lot to learn. Number one thing that I want you to know about concussion is that there's no MRI or CT scan that's going to show this injury. This is at the cellular level. You can't image this injury. We've looked at spectroscopy, we've looked at functional MRI, we've looked at diffusion tensor imaging, we've looked at all kinds of different imaging modalities, and we don't see this cellular problem. It's an energy crisis that happens at a very microscopic level, and we can't measure it. There's no biomarker. We don't have a blood test. There's nothing that shows up with this injury from a traditional neuroimaging standpoint or a blood standpoint. Number two is that to date, we've really had a lack of targeted ways of approaching this injury. This whole concept I'm going to share with you tonight about there being different types of concussions is completely new information. Exciting, but it's new. There's also tremendous variability in recommendations. How many of you had a concussion in this room that I saw? Raise your hands. That's crazy. And how many of you were told that rest is the way to treat the problem? Raise your hands. Okay. No. Actually, I'm going to argue with that. It's not the way to treat the injury. I'm going to show you how we're going to treat the injury, and it's not going to be by rest in the great majority of time. So given that information and the raise of hands there, I mean, you go to 20 different clinicians, you get 20 different approaches at how to managing this injury. There's no pathways. There's no targeted treatment ways of approaching this injury and getting patients better. It's kind of rest, turn off computers, dark rooms, turn off lights, get out of school, don't exercise. What we've learned in me doing this over a long time is that doesn't work very well. And I'll talk about that as we go. There's also a lack of well-controlled prospective studies on long-term outcomes. How many of you have heard about the football players that are dying of CTE and committing suicide and front page in the New York Times and all the scary things that you read? How many of you have heard about that stuff? Okay. I can tell you there's not a single scientific study that proves that concussion in and of itself is causing those problems in those individuals. Not a single study. We haven't studied a cohort of patients for 40 years and controlled for steroid use, controlled for anti-inflammatories, controlled for depression, controlled for alcohol use, controlled for migraines, controlled for other dementing illnesses and neurodegenerative conditions, and determined that concussion in and of itself is what ends up causing that tauopathy. I've looked at the slides, I've seen the brains, there is something abnormal going on there. There's no question. But what is the actual cause of that is left up for scientific debate. We don't have answers. That's not what you're hearing in the media. Absence of proof doesn't mean proof of absence, however. What I mean by that is just because there isn't a study proving it, it doesn't mean there may not be something to it. And that's what I'm faced as a clinician every day and getting kids back to play safely, which is kind of scary stuff, right? Right? I can tell you in the last year, we see 20,000 cases a year at our clinic. And I can count on one hand how many times I've retired an athlete from play. The reason why is because they get better. They're not having symptoms when we put them back to play. And our treatments have advanced. Does that mean that they're not going to get tauopathy down the road? I don't know. We need more science, okay? I don't think so. I don't think it bites you 20 years down the road after we treat this, but we don't have those long-term studies. They just don't exist. And it makes everyone uncomfortable. But that's what's being told in the media, and that media hysteria is really driving public perception. Do you realize that 12 years ago, 15 years ago, I had to argue with dads and moms about holding their kids out of play? And now I have to argue with dads and moms about putting them back to play. The pendulum has swung from here to here. I happen to believe the truth is right in the middle. I think it's worse than we thought, and I don't think it's nearly as bad as it's being made out to be. There's been an incredible amount of awareness created with this injury, but awareness with no solution is called hysteria, and that's what's happening. And because of that, because clinicians don't know how to treat it, kids are retreating to dark rooms and getting depressed and anxious and getting more migraine and all kinds of crazy stuff. That's not the way we approach it. Well, we actually did a Harris poll on this topic because we want to see what the public perception was of concussion. And so we commissioned the Harris poll to do this study in 2016, and I can tell you it was a 10-page document, but there were four statistics that I thought would be interesting to share with you. 24% of U.S. adults think a concussion is going to change their life forever, okay? 80% believes that damage to the brain is permanent. I don't believe that. 81% are not comfortable that they would know the steps to manage and treat a concussion if they sustain one. You know what the number one treatment for concussion was, other than rest? Advil. That's what they stated. We can do better than that. We actually have pretty good treatments for this stuff. And now 25% of U.S. adults will not allow their children to play contact sports, not just football, but contact sports, because of fear of concussion. 71% of pediatricians in a study last month stated they would not allow their son to play football. 71% of pediatricians said that. I'm a dad of four daughters. They play soccer. If I had a son, I would let them play football. Absolutely, unequivocally. I think sports are wonderful. I think it teaches so much to kids. It taught me a lot. Now, I'm not putting blinders on, okay? I'm in this field every day, all day. I know the science. I know what we're learning. I know what we're seeing. And I don't know. I think there's a lot we can do with this injury. I think it's really, again, time to change the conversation as well. So let's talk about this injury. It's heterogeneic, number one. Again, there's different problems that happen. There's different risk factors, there's different biopsychosocial factors, there's different biomechanics. The brain's an incredibly infinitely complex organ. We have 22 different symptoms of concussion, ranging from light sensitivity to nausea to fatigue to balance problems to vision change to concentration issues to anxiety and mood problems, sleep problems. I could list off 22 different symptoms of concussion. It's a highly complex neurological condition. But yet, as a field, we're trying to come up with these protocols. You know, manage it this way in every case. You're going to fail if you do that. This is a very complex injury that needs to be assessed in a complex way, looked at in a complex way, and treated in a complex way. We're never going to manage concussion with a single protocol. It doesn't work. We have to manage. It's about process. It's not about protocol. So with that said, because there's no biomarker for concussion, we've had to come up with tools to measure this injury and create objective ways of looking at this that aren't biomarkers. And we've done a lot of that work in Pittsburgh. We've developed the impact test, which is one of the neurocognitive tests that's used out there. How many of you have heard of baseline testing? How many of you have kids in school here in Maine that play sports? How many of your kids have undergone that testing? That's amazing to see. And you can thank Bill Hines for that. Where's Bill? Bill's right there. Bill's from Maine. He's a primary care physician that has done incredible work in your state and has brought that testing to the state of Maine. And because of that, how many kids have been tested in the state of Maine, Bill? Thousands. Many thousands. Thank you, Hannah. And that baseline testing really helps us as clinicians. It's very important information. And it wouldn't have happened without Bill and Hannah and folks at Colby and all this type of stuff that are going on. But I can tell you that testing is one tool. It's not a panacea. It's a piece of information that we can use, but we have to look at other things. We started to learn that there's other problems that come from concussion besides cognitive. In fact, there's two different problems. One is called a vestibular problem. So the vestibular system is a system that sits in the brain. It's kind of like our gyroscope. And we're not talking ears. We're talking central brain that allows us to interpret movement, motion, allows us to stabilize our vision when we move our head, allows us to interpret busy environments like this, allows us to be in car rides, allows us to exercise, allows us to be in a grocery store. Any movement that's occurring around you or you around something, if that system is the system that's decompensated from concussion, you will feel this slow, wavy, dizzy feel, foggy, disassociated, environmentally sensitive. We knew this system is playing, it's a deep brain structure. We knew that the system was playing a role quite a while ago, but we had to create a tool to look at it. So we created a tool called the VOMS. I'm going to talk about that. But we also know that the eyes are also, you know, 65% of the cells in our brain are devoted to eye movement. And that system can decompensate, and you can have problems moving your eyes side to side, converging your vision, diverging your vision, accommodating your vision. And so we had to have tools to look at that as well. And so we've created those tools, and these tools are highly sensitive and specific to concussion. They work. They really do. But it's not a blood test. And you have to look at all of this to determine, again, where is the aberrant signal coming from? What type of concussion does the patient have? And these are our tools to do so. Briefly discussing computerized neurocognitive testing, IMPACT is one tool that we developed. There's many other great tools out there. They're all sufficient tools. IMPACT is the first tool that received FDA approval. It received FDA approval this past September, which was a lot of work. There's been over 250 peer-reviewed publications. Over 13 million tests have been conducted since 2006. It's translated in 22 languages. It's used throughout the NFL, Major League Baseball, et cetera, et cetera. It's used across all the military. Now the military is getting baselines for everyone. It's important information. And that tool has now been developed down to age 5. So we have a pediatric test that's FDA approved from ages 5 to 11. And then we have the normal impact test, which is age 11 to 60, and we have other aspects of this coming out. But that tool is what you're familiar with when you hear baseline testing. So we actually will administer that test before the season starts for athletes, and then when there's a concussion, if there's a concussion, we then repeat the test. And it's one piece of information that we can use to determine if there's any objective deficits from the concussion. And it's a pretty sensitive test, 92% sensitive, it's specific. It works. It's very helpful information. But if we didn't look at the vestibular system, the ocular motor system, or understand symptoms as well, we'd probably miss a lot of concussions, okay? So it's a piece of information. The vestibular part of this, we've actually developed a 5-minute exam, physical exam, called the VOMS. We're kind of name challenged in our group. It's not a great name, but it stands for vestibular ocular motor screening, and it's the first physical exam aimed at measuring concussion through the vestibular and ocular motor systems. And we look at things like pursuits, saccadic eye movements, near point of convergence. So every human being should be able to look at a target and make it one until 5 centimeters from their nose, and then you get diplopia or see double. We see patients with concussion that will get diplopia at 10, 12, 15, 20, 30 centimeters out, and that's what's called a convergence insufficiency. And quite a significant problem for patients that go through this. They'll struggle in math, science, and really struggle big time with that. And a lot of, probably 95% of clinicians don't look at that. And kids that go back to class and have problems in math and reading and science, that's what's going on. It's just no one's looking at it. We can treat it with physical therapy. And how many kids have that problem that don't get treated? Probably tens of thousands of kids whose math grades will drop, they'll struggle in school. The symptoms you get from that problem is you feel really tired, you get this frontal headache, and you can't do math really well and science really well because you got to process a lot of visual information. There's probably kids in every classroom across the state that are having some of these problems that aren't being, maybe not in Maine, but in other states, right, Bill? So anyhow, we also look at something called vestibular ocular reflex. Everyone hold out your thumb like this, okay? And now look at your thumb and move your head back and forth. About that speed, do it about 10 seconds, okay? How many of you got really dizzy with that? Okay, how many of you that raised your hand have a history of car sickness? Everyone that raised their hands has a history of car sickness. That's called the vestibular ocular reflex, and it allows us to stabilize our vision when we move our head. You shouldn't get dizzy doing that. And patients that did get dizzy, if you get hit in the head, that's the problem you're gonna have. And that system will decompensate, and it makes you feel really dizzy, foggy. It makes you feel tired. It makes you feel environmentally sensitive. You don't like grocery stores. You don't like shopping malls, car rides. And guess what? The vestibular system is actually connected in the brain to the emotional pathways, same pathways. And so that people that have a vestibular problem get very anxious. And when they get anxious, they'll then avoid activities that make them feel that way. Kind of human nature, right? They don't want to be in busy places. They don't want to exercise. They don't want to go out socially. And they start rabbit-holing. Do you know how you treat a vestibular problem? You treat it by exposure. Rest is the worst thing you can do to treat that problem. Okay? That's just one type of concussion. We look at that in both horizontal and vertical ways. We also look at something called visual motion sensitivity. Everyone put the thumb out. Don't hit your neighbor. But now look at your thumb and go around the room 180 degrees. All right? And I see the girl that has a history of car sickness. She doesn't like that very much, the girl in the sweatshirt. That is also, how many got dizzy doing that? You should, actually a few more people should get dizzy doing that. Mostly females. Females are more at risk for that pre-existing wise. That's another test we look at with concussion. Other than Bill Hines and from folks at Colby, there's probably maybe, what do you think, Bill? Maybe 97% of pediatricians across this country do not look at that issue. And that's one of the most important issues to look at with concussion. Just another piece of information. So what we do is when we put this information together, when we look at impact and the VOMS and we look at, you know, exertion and we look at symptoms, once we put that all together, that's what we do to formulate our diagnosis. That's what we do to formulate our prognosis. Do you realize that we publish studies that I can predict outcome now with concussion pretty sensitively? 90% of the time, if you have this profile, this profile, this profile, I know recovery is going to take more than a month. We're pretty good at prognosis. We're really good at diagnosis. Our sensitivity and specificity is now well above 90% in diagnosing this injury. It's getting better. We have tools to look at this stuff, and not many people understand that. And we also use this information to determine treatment and rehab, and also to determine return to play. And this is a lot of work that we've done looking at this. Now, this is the most important slide I'm going to show you, because these are the different types of concussions. We've actually learned that there's 6 different types of concussions, according to our group and according to our research. Vestibular, which is that system we were just looking at. Ocular motor, which is your eye movements, okay? Cognitive fatigue, which is basically patients that have cognitive issues and get really tired as the day goes on. Migraine, which is what it sounds like, that by International Headache Society guidelines, that means headache with nausea and or lighter noise sensitivity, and sometimes these headaches can be really nasty. Cervical issues, so I know there's a chiropractor in the audience, we do see some neck stuff, and some of these symptoms can come from the neck, not all of them. In fact, we've shown that not a lot of them come from the neck, but some can, and you got to rule that out. And anxiety and mood. Now, these are not mutually exclusive. You can have this going on with this and this. And in fact, what we find is that patients with vestibular dysfunction are more likely to get anxious. And then when they get anxious, guess what happens? They get migraine, because migraine comes on in people that are anxious, that are napping, that don't exercise. Those are the biggest risk factors for migraine. So patients will end up with this problem, which then becomes this problem, which then becomes this problem, and guess where migraine presents through? Migraine presents through the oculomotor system and the vestibular system. That's actually, migraine comes out through those systems, okay? And so what you end up having is this vicious cycle of problems that started here and spread over like a virus and starts going all over the place. I treat patients from all over the world, and I can tell you that I see patients 5 years out from this that are having these problems. I've had them every day of their lives. They're not working. They're not exercising. We can treat it. We can actually get them better. I promise you that's the case. There's growing evidence to support this model. In fact, there's been reams of papers published, a lot by our group, a lot by other groups, now understanding that it's a heterogeneic injury and that there's different types of problems that go on from concussion. And what we've also learned, as I've discussed, is that concussion fights dirty. Whatever you bring to the table that's weak gets outed more commonly in that person because it's an energy problem. So you get a history of migraine, you're going to get migraine. Car sickness, vestibular issues. You got a history of lazy eye, you're going to get oculomotor problems. Okay? You have a history of anxiety, you're going to get anxious. Concussion fights dirty. So whatever you bring to the table that pre-exists, we actually find, and we've published papers on every single one of these issues, is that, you know, all these different types of concussions have different risk factors. You want to hear an interesting statistic, is that there is a grossly reduced incidence of these pre-existing issues in NFL players versus high school players. What does that tell you? That tells you that NFL players, you could hit them over the head with a 2x4. It's a selection bias. You don't make it to the NFL if you got a history of car sickness. They get weeded out, okay? And if I looked at the Steelers, there's very few of our Steelers that have these pre-existing risk factors, because if they did, they probably wouldn't be playing in the NFL. And that's why at the high school level, there's so much more risk. And we also understand, what's the one thing that we have done as kids? Oh, I'm not a kid, but there's a little girl here I saw. What does she do differently than we did when I was a kid? What's the one thing that's hugely different? Thank you very much. She held up her cell phone. All right? You see this little thing? And you see all the computers we're using? Don't you think that all that computer use and cell phone use might be playing a role in the increased incidence of concussion? Do we think that the brain is myelinized enough to handle all that stuff, and that might make that system a little decompensate a little easier? That's probably what's going on a little bit with this injury. We haven't proven that, but it certainly makes a lot of sense to me. So what we also know is that we've now created treatments for every one of these different types of concussions. And you have to do it in a very nuanced way. If you have one problem, you got to treat it differently than another problem. But one thing I want you to notice on this chart is that there's not a single circle that advocates for rest. Exercise actually helps migraine. Movement helps vestibular dysfunction. Exposure and rehabituation retrains the vestibular system. The way you treat an ocular problem is by retraining it. It's not by rest. It's not by keeping kids out of math class. It's by exposure. How do you treat anxiety? You put them back in the anxious environment is what you do. I have to tell patients all day long to do things that they don't want to do, and they get better. It's interesting, right? And what do you? How many of you raised your hand that you were told to rest after this injury? A lot of you. It's not going to work real well. And this stuff can actually end up causing a lot of problems if you don't actively treat it. So this is kind of our model. You bring certain risk factors to the table, you get hit in the head, you get different types of concussions, you got to treat and rehab it totally differently. This is our clinic in Pittsburgh. We see 20,000 patients a year. We get referrals from emergency rooms, primary care, athletic trainers, complicated out-of-region referrals. We got 8 clinics around the state, around the city, 35 faculty and staff. We're the point guards, but then under the same roof, we have all our treating specialists. So we have primary care, PM&R, psychiatry if needed, neck specialist, neurosurgery, orthopedic surgery. As a program director, I've got 35 doctors and faculty and staff working as a team to treat this injury. So if you come to Pittsburgh, you're going to have appointments all day with these different people. We're going to create a treatment plan and get you better. Send you home. There's your treatment plan. And we're getting pretty good at that stuff. And there's a lot of progress that's being made in terms of how to treat this. So that's all fine and dandy. You know, all that stuff I just told you is kind of how we approach this, and it's exciting, it's new. But now comes the hard part, science, right? I kind of cut down this lecture a little bit tonight because I wanted to create dialogue. But we've published extensively on this. I could send you papers on all this stuff. But one of the more important papers that we had is we had this meeting in Pittsburgh in October 2015. We called it the Team Approach to Concussion, where we had 37 invited experts from around the country, as well as representatives from the NFL, Major League Baseball, USA Soccer, et cetera, all the military organizations, and also Centers for Disease Control, National Institutes of Health. We invited all these people to Pittsburgh. We met in a room for 3 days. And we actually had a consensus meeting where we voted on, this is the first ever meeting on treatment for concussion that's ever existed academically. And it was a voting meeting, and we all agreed on certain concepts as to how to approach concussion. And everything I shared with you was agreed upon by this group. And it wasn't a cherry-picked group. There were people from all kinds of different disciplines. And some of the things we voted on is that concussions are characterized by diverse symptoms and impairments and function resulting in different clinical profiles and recovery trajectories. You have to match the right treatment to the right problem, and that we can improve outcomes that way. Active treatment strategies need to be initiated early in the process. We are treating this aggressive. You come see me, I'm going to work you out pretty quickly, probably the same day I see you. We're going to actually exert you, because if I can work you out, I can actually see if the vestibular system's decompensated. We can actually measure this stuff in very sophisticated ways, and then once we find where it's coming from, we can actually treat it with movement and activity. Totally different than what's being done. And the last thing we voted on, and we had unanimous agreement on this statement, is that concussion is treatable. That's important information. And it sounds simple, it sounds pedantic, but it's something that is actually very powerful. Because you saw that Harris poll, you saw the information out there. There's a lot of people getting mistreated. There's a lot of people not getting the right things to be done. And there's a lot of concern and worry. When in fact, I think sports are a wonderful thing for kids. And it's something that can really help. So let's get back to the case study. So here, you saw the video. It wasn't that long ago. So after this video, I can tell you that I ended up seeing him a couple days after his injury. And I'm going to bore you with all the great details, but we actually found there was 3 different types of problems he was having. Vestibular, oculomotor, and he had a migraine that kind of came on about a day after the injury. And he walked into my office 2 days later and had a big smile on his face and said, "Doc, I got a football game in 7 days, my man. You got to get me back to play." I said, "Okay, let's do our job. Let's look at you. Let's evaluate this. Let's try to get you back. I'm going to try to get you better, but let's see if we can do that or not." He wasn't doing real well. So, with the treatments that we have, we actually started vestibular therapy right away. We started some oculomotor exercises. We actually, with migraine, you have to treat that behaviorally. No nap. Don't ever let kids with concussion nap. It causes migraine. You want them regulated. Go to bed same time, wake up same time, even on the weekends. You want them walking and doing some form of exercise and treadmill, not treadmill necessarily, but stationary bike. If there's a big vestibular problem, they're not going to be able to do this, because if you push an injured vestibular system too hard, you can get migraine. If you push it too little, you don't get better. So you got to nuance the movement, all right? So we got him exercising a little bit. You want a really good diet, hydration. You want to reduce stress. This guy is the least stressed out person in the world, okay? This guy doesn't have an ounce of anxiety in his body. But he was worried about playing the next week, you know? But, I mean, that's kind of par for the course. But anyways, we implemented all these treatments with him. And I can tell you, we were not successful in getting him back to play in the next week. I saw him on Tuesday. He came in, his data on impact was severely impaired, his exam was all messed up. He was having sort of this oculomotor stuff, something called an alternating exophoria, where his eyes were drifting off, left, right, left, right. he was sick. He did not look good. And it was a very easy call to make to not let him play. And no one argued with me. It's not like there's this, this thing where we're putting all these players back to play with problems. No, we're not doing that. We're holding them out and treating it correctly. We actually held them out of the playoff game. Steelers lost, and we held them out of the Pro Bowl. We actually implemented behavioral management stuff. We did vestibular therapy. We did oculomotor therapy, and we did exertion therapy. I'll just give you a flavor of some of the. This is not him, but you're going to see here. This is one of the things we do for visual motion sensitivity. I know it looks funny, but it works. And you have to rehabituate that system. So I'll just show you a quick video here. This is one of the things we do.
Okay, so Sean, we're in this room with all of this motion going on, the lights going on around you, because you're having difficulty with lots of movement, lots of visual motion, and this will help to desensitize that. So we're going to first let you get used to kind of having this going on around you.
So we have him do a lot of vestibular movements inside that area for high-level visual motion sensitivity. We also have oculomotor stuff we do. Where it's just things,
so
rehab that we've created to desensitize
the
oculomotor system.
Background. You're going to move your eyes from A to Z for me as quickly as you can.
And we also have things like this where we do oculomotor tracking exercises. It looks kind of like silly, but this stuff will work. And if you can desensitize that system, the final treatment we have is actually by working patients out. And this wide receiver had a lot of problems with vertical VOR, so this stuff, okay? And every time he'd look down, he'd get dizzy. And what we had to do is retrain that system. So we do all those exercises, and then we can create a workout program that actually desensitizes. And he also had a horizontal vestibular ocular reflex problem, so you can retrain it this way. That was right before we put him back to play. So athletes want treatment. They want active treatment. I can show patients why they're sick. In fact, I love to do it. Patient looks at me and says, "Micky, I feel great." I'm like, "Okay, let's go down and work you out." And I can work them out in certain ways, and we can elicit the problems. And when you elicit the problems, you can then show the athlete, this is why you're sick. This is what we're going to do to treat and rehab it. It's a whole different animal than retreat to a dark room. So this is his case. He has played 1.5 seasons with no symptoms or problems. Hopefully, he will do well against the Patriots in a few weeks. And this was his data on impact. You can see initially he was below the first percentile, below the first percentile, below the first percentile. That's not very good. This is where he ended up being at the end of all our treatments. And the only reason that score is a little low is because he's kind of careful in how he took the test.
But his, you know, 24 out of 100, whatever, I can't see that number, I think it's 80%. So 20 out of 100, 40, so that's his improvements. Now remember, this guy was telling me he was normal here. Does that make sense to you? I mean, he was pretty messed up. And once you understand where it's coming from, you can kind of treat it and get these guys better. And that's what happened. So in summary, what are we learning? A lot. This is a heterogeneic injury. There's different types of problems that arise from concussion. You need to look at this with different tools and different metrics. If you understand your tools, you can really start to approach it in a more sophisticated way. Those tools allow us to determine specific clinical profiles. You match your problem to the treatment. You improve outcomes. Active treatments are indicated. The only patient I will rest is a patient that is in the middle of a really bad migraine. And rest doesn't mean take naps. It means kind of like not push them too hard. I have taken a kid with bad migraine out of school for a day or two, but I bet you I haven't taken a kid out of school for more than 2 days in probably over a year. I keep them in there because I want them on a routine. I want them going to school, eating breakfast, lunch, dinner, being in that environment, exposing themselves to things. It works. And again, concussion treatment is about process, not about protocol. And this is a treatable condition. I wanted to end with a brief video of a race car driver that was treated at our clinic and is a wonderful human being. In fact, I actually talked to Susan about this, but he actually is going to be talking on this issue, and he's done a few presentations for me at various places, and he's just very well spoken. He went through hell with this injury for a long time, and he got treated, and it was pretty cool to see him do well. But this is a nice little 2-minute video that kind of explains his case.
When the tire blew, I was going about 200 miles an hour. I knew when I hit that wall, it's going to be the hardest hit I'd ever had. I've had concussions before, but this was so different. I felt very trapped inside my head. One of the guys on my crew, he was like, "Man, you look off. You look like you're staring through me." I got to Talladega about 4 weeks after that test crash, and the leaders crashed. The guy popped me right behind the seat like a shotgun going off.
"You okay, buddy?"
"I don't know. I don't know how many of them hits like that I could take."
As soon as I got out of the car, I'm like, something's wrong with my head again. I was really moody, very angry. I couldn't go anywhere where people were. I was, you know, very scared. I went to some local doctors. They insisted that we go to Pittsburgh, to UPMC.
The biggest thing for Dale was answering his questions. He wanted to know why he was feeling the things he was feeling. Through our research, we've been able to isolate 6 different types of concussions. Because this is an invisible injury, it is so cryptic to go through. If your vestibular system is injured, you feel the sense of being depersonalized, detached, feel like you're on Neptune, is the way patients describe it.
I walked into UPMC and I felt like I was at a concussion mini camp. I was like, this is where I need to be.
We understand this injury better than anyone.
We went through all these activities that had results that made sense and exercised the parts of your brain that are confused, and things got better. I look back at the decisions I made in the past to try to man up and make it through on my own. It almost cost me my career. It almost, cost me my happiness. With the care that I got at UPMC, back to doing what I love to do.
Holy cow, man, we just won the 500.
Learn more at rethinkconcussions.com.
I am not an automotive guy. I am more now after treating him. But this is a picture of Dr. Cummings at our house in Cape Elizabeth, and that's my wife, Lynn. That is my daughter, my daughter, my daughter. That is not my daughter. That is my other daughter, and that's Brock Holt of the Red Sox. Good guy. But anyhow, we're Mainers. We're proud of it. I am so thankful for the education I've had here and to take what my foundation I learned here and to take it out and to do this area with passion and with commitment. I don't think I'd be able to do it without the education I had here. Coach Flaherty, thank you for being a hard ass. It's been a good, great ride, and I really appreciate the opportunity to come back. Thank you very much. I would be happy to
I'm a windbag. I went over. But I'd be happy to, actually, maybe not too much, actually. That's good. Let's, any questions? And hopefully there are questions. Yes?
Do you think there is a microvascular component to these injuries that also contributes to it?
We don't know. One of the findings in the pathology reports of patients with CTE are perivascular lesions, what's called Virchow-Robin spaces, which is something that we had found on some of the MRI imaging we had done back in the mid-2000s. It has not been reported on greatly until the recent pathology slides have come out of BU. We don't know. Again, is that concussion that's causing those perivascular lesions, or is it something else? We're not entirely sure, but I think your question is apropos and perhaps relevant to some of the things we're seeing with the pathology. Yeah. Yes.
One of your earlier slides showed potassium migrating out and calcium migrating in.
Right.
Can you use that to quantify how bad a concussion is?
No, we can't measure it. It's not something you're going to pick up on any neurodiagnostic instrument. We've looked at it, trust me. It's not something that's seen readily on imaging. You're not going to see it in MRI. You're not going to see it on SPECT or PET or anything functional. Those studies have been done. Maybe a neurosurgeon or two might argue with me that they're seeing some aberrant signals there in some of the functional imaging that's done, but nothing consistent. There's no imaging modality that's ready for prime time with this injury. You're welcome. Yes? Not a lot. Helmets do a phenomenal job of preventing against skull fracture, subdural hematoma, epidural hematoma, things that can kill you. And helmets are wonderful for that very reason. But until we find a helmet that goes around the brain itself, there's not a lot we can do about preventing the brain from moving inside the skull because it's encased in fluid, much like an egg yolk inside an eggshell. And so one could actually argue that helmets have increased the incidence of concussion because people with helmets are more likely to use their head as weapons. Now, I get the question, we do a lot of work in Europe, and I get the question, well, why doesn't American football just become rugby? And I can tell you that rugby has far more serious, catastrophic injuries than we see in football. And the concussions that are sustained in rugby are pretty serious. So I don't think that's a real good idea. Yes? Absolutely, I do. Now, do we treat everyone to 100%? No. We've had outcomes that are difficult, for sure. But I'm pretty confident that if a patient comes to me with problems, we can treat them and get them better. And most of the time, get them completely well, but not all the time. Especially if it's very complicated, there's some risk factors that happen that sometimes we can't treat. You know, there's some patients that have had a lot of history and a lot of problems that are difficult to treat, but I can tell you that we can do a lot more than probably what a lot of folks can do in terms of treating it. Yes. Yes.
Do you kind of see a difference in the treatment due to age with the variation of like adult population versus pre-hormonal or hormonal teenagers versus underdeveloped brain?
Yeah, that's a great question. I had that question today. I gave a little lecture to one of the classes here. And we published studies where we looked at high school kids versus college athletes. High school kids take longer to recover. High school kids versus professional athletes, they take longer to recover. That's probably due to myelinization issues, but it may be due to some of these risk factors we're talking about too. Got to be careful with that. And we just published a paper in JAMA actually looking at hormones and concussion and perimenstruation times for females. That's really a bad time to get a concussion. So there's definitely some hormonal issues at our play. We also know girls are 4 to 6 times more likely to have concussion, to have longer outcomes from concussion than boys. And some of that's due to that hormonal stuff. Some of it's due to the fact that females are 4 to 6 times more likely to have migraine, and some of it's due to neck strength. But girls are going to have worse outcomes than boys, according to all the research that's out there. Yes? I don't like the idea of prisms because you're compensating for the patient. Now, there are some cases, very rarely, where we'll use prisms to help them compensate for a while, but that is not the answer because you're not allowing the brain to rehabituate itself. And I am actually I'm a strong proponent of not using prisms in the great, great majority of neuro-optometric cases just because of that issue. I want patients to relearn how to do it rather than being compensated in some other way. Yes? We're doing it right now. We're going to start a very well-controlled prospective study in a bunch of kids playing football, and we're going to follow them for many decades, and we're going to look at what happens. And that's what's needed. We need prospective data where we're controlling for all these life factors that could be contributing to that. There's also some great work being done at the NFL level. We're going to look at a cohort of NFL players and a cohort of non-NFL players that didn't play contact sports and look at the actual incidence of neurodegenerative problems in our football players versus our controls. That hasn't been done. Can you believe that? After reading all you read in the media, it's misinformation. I'm not going to say anything, any other word about I sounded bad there. But no, it is misinformation. Yes. Yes. Right.
What do you think of that? And two, according to what you do, if somebody gets better in 2 days, are you letting them go back?
Yes. And we're doing it in a way that I honestly, it's not about protocol, it's about process for us. And if you come to see me and all our testing is normal and we look at dynamic visual acuity and neurocognitive testing and oculomotor function, we have goggles we can look at with the eyes. There's really sophisticated ways of looking at this. We work them out in certain ways. And if all that stuff comes out normal, yeah, I'm going to put them back to play as long as I'm comfortable with that. It doesn't happen very often. I can tell you, you know what the average recovery time of, we've done these really cool studies where we've taken all comers with concussion. The average recovery time for concussion is actually 3 weeks, probably. But some kids get better quicker and some kids take longer. We just published a study in pediatrics where we looked at two cohorts of patients, okay? So there was 100 kids that had a concussion. 50 of them came out of play immediately at the time they had symptoms, and then 50 continued to play on average for 22 minutes beyond the point of their symptoms. This group got better in 19 days. This group got better in 44 days. 22 minutes of playing beyond the point of having symptoms over doubled the recovery time of our patients. That's why it's so critical to get these kids out of play. Oh, little girl in the front here. Yes?
You see kids or adults more often?
Kids. Yeah, I like kids a lot better than adults. Yes? I think it might surprise you to hear me say that I'm not a big fan of academic accommodations in a lot of patients with this injury. If there's an oculomotor problem, I am definitely doing accommodations because that's the type of concussion that will definitely affect their ability to learn from an academic math reading standpoint. But if I have a patient with anxiety, there is no way I'm doing accommodations because guess what? That's going to worsen the anxiety. I want them to roll up the sleeves and get it done. And I tell them that. And it works. I don't want them stressing. I want them to dive in the deep end of the pool and get it done. But you got to know what type of concussion you're dealing with before you make those recommendations. And so our academic accommodation forms are very thorough. And we have specific accommodations for vestibular, specific accommodations for ocular, specific accommodations for other types of concussions. And I think that's the specificity you should be getting at with your work here in Maine, to be able to accommodate kids the right way, not just throw blanket accommodations for everyone. I think it causes a lot of problems. Yes?
I have two questions, if I may.
Sure.
One, the recency of injury to when the treatment begins.
Right.
Are there correlations there? Like if someone's had an injury and maybe a year or two has gone by, and then they start work with you?
Yeah. It's going to be more complicated. And the sooner we actually have a study coming out on this, the sooner I see someone, the quicker they get better, because we can initiate treatments and get them in the right lane. But patients that come to me a year out, it might take longer, but we can treat it a lot of times. I'm not going to say always, but those patients will get better, and sometimes more quickly than you realize.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They cover all of it, so it's all insurance reimbursable from my in our clinic. It's all insurance driven, so they cover it. Yeah. Yes.
I noticed that ADHD was one of the risk factors.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about how significant a factor that is?
I wouldn't say it's my top five. And sometimes, the ADHD diagnosis is a little slippery sometimes. Sometimes that can actually be anxiety, and sometimes it can be ADHD. Depending on what's really going on there, that issue is, if it's true ADHD, is a risk factor for the cognitive fatigue subtype. And these are patients that have cognitive issues that really, really become fatigued as the day goes on. And for whatever reason, ADHD plays a strong predictive value in predicting that type of concussion. And that's the toughest concussion to treat, by the way. We don't have really good treatments for that one. it's a little more difficult to treat. Up back, yeah.
Oh, thank you. Is there any evidence that with multiple concussions that when a player returns to the game, she has post-traumatic stress?
No, we see post-traumatic stress a lot in our motor vehicle accident patients, in our combat. I work a lot with the military. Mm-hmm. We have a whole clinic day devoted to military, so I see military from all over the country come to us, and they're complicated, and the PTSD stuff really does raise major difficulties in treating it, but we do a pretty good job of that. Do you know how we treat PTSD? It's by exposure, right? You know, you don't want to avoid noxious stimuli.
Why do we hear that some of these athletes are redshirted for the season if recovery can be shorter than taking them out of for the entire season?
It's a great question. I mean, I when I hear someone that's retired from concussion, I wonder what's really going on a lot of times. I don't know. I mean, I haven't seen that case necessarily, right? So I don't know what the issues are, but I feel it's a treatable condition. Yes, in the red vest there.
What happens to an individual with concussion that doesn't have the benefit of this therapy?
I don't know. It's a really good question. I would assume there's a lot of patients with migraine out there that probably shouldn't have migraine. I'd assume there's a lot of patients with anxiety that shouldn't have anxiety. I assume there's patients with ocular problems that shouldn't have ocular problems, vestibular problems that get carsick more easily, that are environmentally sensitive. There's probably some depression going on. It's not fun. And the patients that we see 2 or 3 years out from this, their lives change. There is huge morbidity with these issues. There's 1.8 to 3.6 million concussions occurring per year in this country. And what percent of those end up with morbidity, we don't know. Those studies haven't been done. But it's a very, very relevant question. Best question of the night. And I don't have an answer for it. Yes. In some of our post-traumatic stress patients, they'll go through that treatment and it seems to benefit them, but there's been no research looking at EMDR and outcomes from concussion that I'm aware of. Its relevancy and efficacy is something that I would applaud someone to study it. Yes. Well, that's a very difficult question. We actually find some patients with moderate TBI do way better than patients with concussion. We've had this, you know the nomenclature, right? Mild, moderate, severe TBI. And for some reason, we put that on a continuum. I don't look at the injury that way. Some of our milds are worse than our moderates. Now, our severes are a different animal. And those are hard to treat. And some of the therapies I'm telling you about would not be effective with some of those patients. It's just as a field, we've kind of like tried to use that nomenclature, and I'm not a big fan of it because I think it's way more complicated than that nomenclature is, if that makes sense to you. You're welcome.
Yes.
Do you see a concussion in men as being different and distinct from concussion in women?
Not really. No. No, I don't. I feel that we see more women because there's more risk factors for that. Probably 60% of our patients are women versus 40% male because they have a history of migraine and have a history of car sickness and those sorts of things more readily in that population. But the outcomes are pretty similar. You know, a lot of times the presentation's similar. I think women are tougher than men a lot of times. Joking. Yes. I have four daughters that would argue that point for sure. Yeah. It's a great question. A lot of the focus right now in the media is focused on football, and so we're doing the football study. We are involved in the largest study ever done, the NCAA study. They call it the Framingham Heart Study of Concussion, where we're looking at, I think there's 28 schools involved, and I'm one of the investigators in that study, and we have a huge amount of females in that population, so there's really good data coming forth from a female side too. And that's a good prospective study that good answers will come from, and that will address some of those issues. It's the NCAA study on concussion. If you look, it's very, very widely. I think there's 28 schools and universities involved in it, thousands and thousands of athletes. Yes? Yeah, it's hard. Anxiety, I often say this, if you don't know how to treat anxiety, you don't know how to treat migraine, you shouldn't be treating concussion, because those two things are ubiquitous and throughout our patients. And we see a lot of comorbid anxiety in these patients. It's also chicken or egg. You know, did it come before the injury and then the injury exacerbated, or did it, you know, it's very difficult to disentangle, but I can tell you that anxiety is rampant in our patients. And that's why dark rooms are really bad. What happens when you're anxious? You go to a dark room. You ruminate. What happens when you ruminate? You become less social. You start less exercise. You get migraine. And when you feel bad, you start doing it over and over again. And we see patients that are in that cycle that have horrible outcomes. I bet you every day or every week I see a patient that's overtly suicidal from this stuff. It's true. I mean, it can lead to very scary places for patients to be. It's quite impressive the morbidity that can happen in that specific area. Yes? Sure are, yeah. Oh my goodness, there's so much work to be done. I actually have an affinity for working with geriatric patients. I think it's my grandfather's thing. My mom's dad had dementia stuff going on, and I've always had an affinity for that population. So I do a lot of work with geriatric patients that have falls. I like seeing them. I make sure I have time in my clinic for them, and I can tell you the outcomes are pretty significant, and the treatments are horrible for that population. There's a lot of people have not been treated after falls, and there's a lot of morbidity, and there's a lot of problems that arise because of it. So I can tell you there's no research on it, zero, as it relates to concussion. More work needs to be done. One more, Glenn? Yes. Yeah, I actually strongly believe in behavior regulation. Like when kids, before they go to do two-a-days in football, for example, make sure they're not taking naps, make sure they're hydrated, make sure they're eating regularly, make sure they're not stressed out, because that threshold for concussion will lower, okay? Neck strength, hugely important to mitigate the effects of concussion. And knowledge, understanding the subtleties of this injury, and if you get out of play, you get better a lot quicker. And knowing the subtleties of the injury is so important. So those would be my big prevention sort of shticks. No. Mouth guards, helmets, you know, cue collar, all this stuff is very little research to support any of that in terms of mitigating the effects.
Please join me in thanking you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you again for being here tonight and being with us at Corporate Partners. We really appreciate Dr. Collins for being here. Thank you for being here, and I hope you found this helpful, and USM is proud to support it. Thank you.